Does anyone remember watching the show Monk, starring Tony Shalhoub? It's the story of a private detective with obsessive-compulsive disorder, and it has a theme song by Randy Newman called It's a Jungle Out There. While I enjoy streaming it as a bit of escapist TV, the theme has seemed especially relevant these last few weeks. It is a jungle out there. It might interest you to know that these worship series aren't packaged products. They don't come scripted with graphics and sermon outlines and hymn suggestions. Guided by the Holy Spirit, they are first conceived by Pastor Matthew and his colleagues on planning retreats. Next, Pastor Matthew brings these back to the staff, and we bring them to life with the communications department, trying to discern and create what would be a good anchor image for the series. I wonder, how would you represent the jungle that's out there? The daily rat race, the intensity and chaos that is life in Northern Virginia in the post-COVID era prior to a presidential election, and that God offers a method to that madness. Would it be time-lapse photography of lights at night, you know, sort of that blurry swish that you see? Would it be bumper-to-bumper traffic? Would it be a mom who looks frantic, juggling children and housework and errands? Maybe a businessman that looks harried due to proposal deadlines? Would it be kids that are trying to manage extracurriculars along with academics? Your image would probably be influenced by your reality. And we wanted something relatable to everyone, so we came up with this. A variety of unlit light bulbs with tangled or twisted cords. Now perhaps you feel like that first light bulb, the most chaotic of them all. If so, God bless you and help you. But maybe you're one of the others, and notice only the straight cord, the orderly cord, produces light. Wherever you find yourself on this scale of madness, as it were, there is a better way. God came to earth and Jesus over 2,000 years ago to help us with through the madness unique to every age, nation, and people. In the Gospel of John, that poetic gospel, Jesus says, "I am the light of the world. I will show you a way in the darkness." And Jesus also said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. When you get lost, confused, bewildered, flustered, or overwhelmed, look to me and I will show you a more excellent way." Said differently, "I will make it plain. I will keep it simple. I will offer you a method to the madness." And so in this series, we are sharing with you some United Methodist-inspired rules for living. They are lamp posts in the darkness, guideposts and guardrails along the way, all modeled after the life and teachings of Jesus and our understanding of what it means to live as faithful disciples of Jesus Christ. And we have this wonderful three-legged table, courtesy of Kim Wu, as another visual and tangible illustration. So the first Sunday, we learned about the Wesley Quadrilateral, right? That Scripture contains all things necessary for salvation. So that makes the importance of reading Scripture primary. So Scripture was up here on the top of that table, if you recall. And our understanding and application of Scripture is supported and informed by three legs. They were, anybody remember? Starts with a T, T-R, tradition. Reason and experience, right? So tradition, reason, and experience upheld our understanding of Scripture. And on the second Sunday, we learned that the way of salvation is made possible through God's word and God's grace. We understand that grace to be known to us as prevenient grace, justifying grace, and sanctifying grace. So that way of salvation was supported and strengthened by prevenient, justifying, and sanctifying grace. First, God woos us, then we're made right with God in relationship with Christ, and we continue to grow in godliness and righteousness throughout our lives through the work of the Holy Spirit. And today, this table comes in handy once again. God's word and God's grace are at work in our lives to help us live as faithful disciples of Jesus Christ. That's what is on our tabletop surface today. And if we want to live as faithful disciples of Jesus Christ, then our lives should be upheld by three simple, deceptively simple rules. Do no harm, do good, and stay in love with God. It may sound simple, but it isn't so easy, as we shall see. So let's get started on understanding today's method to the madness, the three simple rules. Now, you won't find the three simple rules in the Bible in this form, but you will find them in the United Methodist Book of Discipline, the book that details our beliefs and how we order our church, found here. The Book of Discipline states, "No motive in the Wesleyan tradition has been more constant than the link between Christian doctrine, that is what we believe, and Christian living, that is what we do." John and Charles Wesley were adamant that discipleship was an active response to God's grace. Methodists don't just read and meditate on Scripture, but they actively serve others. Our faith engages our minds, our hearts, and our hands. The three simple rules, or general rules, as they are sometimes called, were originally designed for members of Methodist societies. Admission to the societies was based upon an individual's desire to flee from the wrath to come and to be saved from their sins. But whenever this is really fixed in the soul, it will be shown by its fruits, Wesley said. In other words, these general rules were expectations for membership by all who continued to offer evidence of their desire for salvation. First, by doing no harm, by avoiding evil of every kind. Second, by doing good of every possible sort and as far as possible to all. And third, by attending upon all the ordinances of God. We'll hear a bit more from John Wesley as we take a closer look at each rule. But now that you know some of the history, I'm going to turn instead to the work by United Methodist Bishop P. Reuben's small book, Three Simple Rules, A Wesleyan Way of Living. This is available on Amazon. It's a great and very short read and a helpful resource. Bishop Jobe's small book is treasured by many United Methodists for the modern way it frames our understanding of those three general or simple rules. So our first rule is do no harm. It is simple. Even a child can understand it. John Wesley suggested this list of don'ts. Avoid evil of every kind. Don't take the name of the Lord in vain. That can be hard sometimes. Don't profane the Sabbath by doing ordinary work. Don't fight, don't quarrel, don't brawl. When's the last time you've brawled with someone? Don't borrow without probability of paying back. These were some of his suggestions. It seems rather straightforward, right? But Bishop Jobe asks us to consider how this rule might be applied, especially with those with whom we disagree, since that's most often when we are likely to do harm. Whether it's the color of the carpet in the church, our favorite band, or the best quarterback, we all have opinions about all sorts of things, don't we? Some opinions, though, are deeply held beliefs, like interpreting Scripture or choosing a political party. And the divisions between us can be deep. So what does disagreeing without doing harm look like? I have some suggestions. We wait to respond in word or action. Just stop a minute and think. Carefully discern your next steps. Be careful not to let our first response be an emotional response. Also, don't gossip or speak disparagingly about someone else, recognizing that everyone is a child of God, beloved by God and made in God's image. And also, don't manipulate the facts in your favor or repeat misinformation. These are some guides to disagreeing without doing harm. Let's take it one step further and consider our social media usage, since that's where a great deal of harm is done these days. When engaging in social media activities in order to do no harm, take time to discern both the intention and the potential consequences of online engagement. What's the intent of the post? Does it show Christ's love, or does it focus on judgment and condemnation? Do I speak disparagingly about anyone involved? Do I try to use facts and opinions to manipulate others to my viewpoint? Could someone interpret the post as harmful, offensive, rude, or distasteful? And does this interaction recognize each person involved as a loved child of God, a recipient of love unearned, unlimited, and undeserved, just like myself? Perhaps this rule, do no harm, is too often misunderstood and oversimplified. Perhaps it demands too much self-discipline, and perhaps we've forgotten that we do nothing from our own strength, but through Christ who is at work within us. So let's consider our first scripture reading from Paul's letter to the Romans. In all his letters, Paul concluded with a list of practical duties that were based on the doctrines he had discussed. In the Christian life, doctrine and duty always went together. That's why we hear Paul talk of taxes, revenue, respect, honor. What we believe helps to determine how we behave. It's not enough for us to understand Paul's doctrinal explanations. We must translate our learning into living and show by our daily lives that we trust God's word. Sounds a lot like the Methodist, doesn't it? And then Paul later speaks of love. Owe no one anything except to love one another, for the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. The commandments, thou shalt not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandment are summed up in this word, love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor, therefore love is the fulfilling of the law. Paul enlarged the circle of responsibility by including other people besides government officials. Love one another is the basic principle of the Christian life. It is the new commandment that Christ gave to us. When we practice love, there is no need for other laws because love covers it all. If we love others, we will not sin against them. As believers, we do not live under the law, but we live under grace. Our motive for obeying God and helping others is the love of Christ in our hearts. And if the love of Christ is in our hearts, then we should do no harm to others. Well, our second rule is do good. John Wesley recommended these ways of doing good: giving food to the hungry, clothing the naked, visiting those that are sick or in prison, helping each other in business, and taking up our cross daily. As Bishop Job states in the Three Simple Rules, doing good, like doing no harm, is a proactive way of living. So what does doing good look like? Doing good is not limited to those like us or those who like us. Doing good is directed at everyone. Doing good is universal, you understand? We don't need to wait to provide help when we perceive the need. Respond quickly. Nor do we need to wait until circumstances cry out for aid to relieve suffering or correct some horrible injustice. Respond early. We can decide that our way of living will come down on the side of doing good to all in every circumstance, in every way. But how much is enough? It reminds me of the familiar saying attributed to John Wesley. Some of you know it, I'm sure. Do all the good you can, by all the means you can, in all the ways you can, in all the places you can, at all the times you can, to all the people you can, as long as ever you can. This statement is commonly referred to as John Wesley's rule, or rule of life. Whether it was written by Wesley or not, it is in full agreement with Wesley's teachings and writings. The statement calls us to holy living and acts of mercy and justice, and how far you take it is really between you and God. Bishop Job writes, "My desire to do good is in response to God's invitation to follow Jesus, and it's in my control. I can determine to extend hospitality and goodness to all that I meet. Doing all the good we can means engaging others proactively in a way that nourishes goodness and strengthens community. We should strive to assess every word and act to determine if it brings God's grace and goodness to others. But it's a learning process, and it doesn't happen overnight." Consider social media once again. How we engage online can have a profound effect on the people with whom we connect. Instead of doing harm, let us use social media to extend hospitality and goodness to all and to just demonstrate God's love to our digital neighbors. Think about every status update, comment, or post as an outlet for doing good and see if your posts don't change. Well, let's look now at one of the scriptural foundations for doing good. In our second scripture reading, Paul's letter to the Galatians, Paul writes, "Do not be deceived. God is not mocked, for you reap whatever you sow. If you sow to your own flesh, you will reap corruption from the flesh. But if you sow to the Spirit, you will reap eternal life from the Spirit. So let us not grow weary in doing what is right, for we will reap at harvest time if we do not give up. So then, whatever whenever we have an opportunity, let us work for the good of all, and especially for those of the family of faith. Paul's point here is clear. Since we will stand before God, we must live now before God, and that means living in the Spirit. Put differently, we must do good to all people, especially to the church, which may well have been neglected by those caught up in the divisions of Galatia that Paul was addressing. Paul speaks of doing good because doing good is what it means to sow the Spirit. This is how we live in the world and not of the world. And we should not become weary in doing good because our labors will not be in vain. Even if we don't see it ourselves, our acts of goodness make a difference. And each time we do so, we're loving our neighbor and following Jesus' golden rule to do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Jesus went on to say in that passage, rather straightforwardly from Luke chapter 6, "If you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? For even sinners love those who love them. If you do good to those who do good to you, what credit is that to you? For even sinners do the same. If you lend to those from whom you hope to receive, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend to sinners to receive as much again. But love your enemies, do good and lend, expecting nothing in return. Your reward will be great, and you will be children of the Most High, for he is kind to the ungrateful and the wicked. Be merciful, just as your Father is merciful." Well, finally, our third rule is to stay in love with God. When speaking about this rule, John Wesley advised the Methodists to attend to God's ordinances by the public worship of God. Yay, you're doing that right now. The ministry of the word read or expounded. The Lord's Supper, that is Holy Communion, family and private prayer, fasting or abstinence. Now, Bishop Jobe writes that ordinance is a strange word on our ears today. John Wesley was describing the practices, really, that keep the relationship between God and humans vital and alive and growing. Instead of ordinances, we might hear this today as spiritual disciplines that help to nurture and sustain our love for God. Spiritual disciplines teach us to live our lives in harmony with something larger than ourselves and larger than that which the world values. Your spiritual disciplines may be among what I've already mentioned, or you may have others. Perhaps you draw close to God by praying in color, or singing or playing music, or gardening or walking or meditating or running. If you're not sure, a spiritual discipline is something that helps keep us positioned in such a way that we may hear and be responsive to God's, and responsive to God and receive God's promised presence and power. It is through these practices that we learn to trust in God as revealed in Jesus Christ, and we are reminded of God's love for us and the world. This is how we tend to our relationship with God and stay in love with God. Living in the presence of and in harmony with the living God, who is made known in Jesus Christ and companions us in the Holy Spirit, is to live life from the inside out. This is where we will find the strength and conviction and courage and compassion to do no harm and do good. To fail in this third rule will certainly mean failure in others, for we cannot pour ourselves out for God if we have not first allowed God to pour into us. As Bishop Jobe writes in his preface, there are three simple rules: do no harm, do good, and stay in love with God, that have the power to change the world. While they are ancient, they have seldom been fully put to the test. But when and where practiced, the world has shaken, and a new formation, a new world, was formed. It happened before through the Methodist movement, and it can happen again through you and me. May we all strive to keep the three simple rules as a method to our madness, trusting Jesus to be our guiding light and to lead the way. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.